So, cross-grain cracks are a pain in the butt because they stand out dramatically after a repair, because we can see them crossing the grain. That's why we call them cross-grain cracks. I try to get them to be, I don't necessarily try to make them disappear as much as I try to get them to look less conspicuous. And I do use a bit of French polishing magic to do this. The first step for me, and if you remember, I've said it before, that to me, a finished repair or a touch-up repair is always going to look better under finish than it does on top of finish. I'm going to move that aside a little bit so I can see what I'm doing. So my first step as part of the repair is going to be to open this crack a little bit, because I want a surface that I can paint into and fill with shellac. I'm not going to try to do the whole thing at once. I'll tip the steps and stages. I can feel that. Should we push up a little bit? So just with a scalpel, I'm going to try to get right into the line that I'm trying to make less conspicuous. And then the hopes that I'm going to be able to try to hide the tree in the forest, we're going to try to get that. I've got it from about here to about up to here. When I say lock in color, it's, you know, it's, I guess it's the equivalent of when you're spraying, when you're doing a touch up and you say, oh, I like what I see there. I want to kind of get it to pause where it is, and then make a decision as to whether or not I need to add this, detract from that, you know, add a little bit of color, or whether or not it's time to start painting in grain lines.
Would you, do you feel like you'd use the same technique even if it wasn't going cross grain? Like, would you use this with a with grain?
Oh, sure.
Crack?
Absolutely. You know, but like the hardest to me, the reason why I want to show this was the hardest thing to do is to try to get rid of a cross grain crack when you're doing a repair, because those are the telltale signs that the repair is taking place. That's looking a little white to me, so I want to scrape a little bit of that off. I'm not worried about filling the trough at this point.
Okay.
So getting my color right, because you're going to see in a second and through the course of a bunch of different repairs today that shellac has this kind of, for lack of a better word, while you're polishing on finish, this miraculous property or characteristic that it fills voids, divots, dings, scratches, and whatnot. I like what I'm seeing there. It's a little white. I might decide to add a little color.
So is there still a divot that you're painting into there, or is that?
I feel a little bit.
Yeah, okay. So you're not proud of the surface of the crack at this point?
No, I might be around the sides of it here.
Mm-hmm.
But then as I then charge my pad a little bit, little bit of shellac, just wipe it on. My color coming down a bit.
Yeah.
And I can get what colors. I'm going to grab a little bit of brown dye.
Are you giving it streaks at this point, or are you still trying to dial in the base coat?
Just trying to dial in my base of the crack.
Okay.
I want to get this, like I said, light, so I have a canvas to paint on.
Uh-huh.
You just have to dip into the fresh shellac to reactivate your color, what you're looking for. If you ever want to know what a color is going to look like before you put it on a guitar, using a glass slide, we'll let you do that as well.
That's a good move.
Do yellow there, I'm not going to do that. The nice thing about shellac is it dries pretty quick. So I can get a look, a little bit more, just a quick swipe of finish. And that'll dry pretty quickly. And I'll be able to see what it's starting to look like underneath that. So my crack is beginning to disappear underneath all of that. What I want to see around it.
So are you fudging on either side of the crack a little bit?
Yeah, I'm just trying to get a blended color that looks like the color behind. What's there. You see the difference of what was here and what's here. I don't want to get too wet with it. I don't want to get too fuzzy with it. But just one swipe and let it dry, kind of diffuse that crack. And the more we French polish over it when it's done, the more hidden it'll be, because it's French polish when you're actually putting a lot of finish on, has kind of a filtering effect. And if I wind up going a little too light, that's fine, because I can always get darker on top of that. But I want a little bit of translucency to my shellac or to my pigment, because I don't want it to stand out dramatically from different angles. I don't want it to be too, but I think that's about where I kind of like it, or where I'm going to want it to sit. I might pull a little bit off of that just by taking my scalpel and doing a little bit of that.
So the scalpel is pulling off shellac or color?
And whatever's there, and I can put some finish over the top of it. I don't want to get too wet, because I really don't want to dissolve what's underneath it. That's why I keep charging a pad that was originally dry, because most of the shellac is just getting sucked into here. So the amount that I put on is much less. If it begins to drag a little bit, I know it's getting a little bit wet, and it is beginning to drag a little bit. So now I've got an area where I've got, I'm not going to do the whole thing, we're not going to go up to the whole crack today, but so I've got from here to here well hidden. And then if I want to start painting in some grain lines or pushing in some grain lines, we can do it with a number of products.
Yeah. So your pad dragon, like, would there be a point at which you're like, okay, this is done for today? Or would you just peel everything back off and start over?
No. If my pad's dragging, that tells me that this area is still wet.
Yeah.
So I don't want it to get too wet. Let me pull back a little bit. I don't want to get this to get too wet where I start getting it wet enough to start pulling my color off.
Yeah.
My goal is to have the finish, and you can see if I go next to it, the finish is starting to get darker.
Yeah.
It's get darker. My goal is to have the finish cover what's there dry, so it locks it in, and I'll let it sit just a few minutes. And once it starts feeling like it's no longer dragging, I can put a little bit more finish on, lock it on, and I'm good to go. So I'll come in here and I'll start This is an oak, so it's a light color. I'll start putting that there, and it'll add the benefit of adding a little bit of that color that I'm missing.
Talk about your finger move there for a sec.
I'm dragging, I'm putting a dimple, like some dots, and I'm dragging them, and that will wind up.
Oh, that looks nice. So that's a dye pen, or is that a?
This is a dye pen. This is what they call traditionally a graining pen.
Is that got shellac in it, or does it have some other binder?
This is just ink. I think that's all it is. I don't think it's a finish base. I don't think it's a solvent base. I think it's just ink.
Is it biting into the shellac there, or is it?
Yeah, it's okay. There. So that's scenario one, where I would use French polishing in finish. And I do that a lot. I'll do that on peg head breaks. I'll do that on cracks like this in the body. I'll do that on splint repairs in a top, where if you're looking to get rid of those cross grain, you know, where the splint ends and has that cross grain line from where your splint is to where the guitar is. If you're doing it with shellac and furniture powders, as opposed to liquid pigments, even if you look at this from the side, it doesn't stand out the way pigments normally do. They stand out like a neon sign. You know, this is much more subtle because the pigment is diffused in the shellac.
It's also one thing I would say too is if it's in a crack, like when you're looking at it on the side, I mean, like you would have a hard time just seeing a crack from the side too. So that's one of the reasons why I think going deep rather than going on the surface is a real winner.